Hello and welcome to a fresh new edition of Taking Stock. This is the show where we look back at the week gone by, but also look ahead as always and prepare you for what's coming up next. We touch upon the big dominating drivers, what to pay attention to, what to ignore, the important stuff and the useless stuff as always. I am Prashant Nair. With me is my colleague Surabhi Upadhyay. Hi Surabhi.
Hi Prashant. What a week. You know, you've gone through 5 days of trade and it's almost as if nothing has moved. I mean, if you're looking at the indices, then this is a week that's been absolutely range bound. In fact, as flat as flat can be. Relatively speaking, the Nifty is up about 0.5% thereabouts, just a little under 0.5%. If you're looking at the bank index, the Nifty Bank, then marginally better off thanks to the rally that we saw in corporate banks this week around. So that index is up about 1%. And mid-caps have been largely lackluster. Some of the selling in the auto sector continued. What was quite evident to note was that it was really all about individual stocks. It was about earnings because the season is finally setting upon us. So volatility along with the numbers was really the hallmark of the day. IndusInd Bank being case in point. Their exposure to Island FS is still raising some eyebrows. So for the week as a whole, that stock has ended down about 2%. And then you talk about the IT titans. That was another big talking point for the week. Margin miss from TCS, and at least at the surface, there's a margin miss from Infosys as well, though both of these companies continue to sound optimistic about the demand environment. So these were some of the watch points. And of course, from the global perspective, Prashant, I think the one thing the market is increasingly taking note of is the way Brent is back above 60, the way the rupee is again getting a little wobbly. We've seen depreciation in this week gone by. Some of these macros, I think, continue to kind of dominate the mindset.
Absolutely. I think, a couple of points. One, of course, is the fact that we started the year with concerns that global growth is slowing down. Mm. Slowing down quite strongly. But if you look at the consumer data, the last two or three bits of consumer data out of the US, it doesn't show that things are as bad. That is point number one. But at the margin, things are slowing down in the US. That is true. The more important point is the reaction to that slowdown. I mean, we came into this year thinking that the Fed, I mean, at least that was the assumption, there will be a couple of rate hikes from the US Federal Reserve. Given the slew of speeches, and I think we've heard some, 10 Federal Reserve representatives, including the Fed chairman, again for the second time, in this week, and the indication is that nothing is on autopilot, nothing is a given. I think that has really soothed nerves and has prompted this very smart bounce that we've seen in the U.S. markets now over the last actually 3 weeks now, right? I mean, so it's the anticipated reaction from the Fed now being extremely soft. And it's been made very clear multiple times by many people, Fed presidents around the United States. So I think that is the critical part. Everything else, nothing else has really changed, but this one factor has boosted risk sentiment in a significant way. I mean, the other factors, US-China trade talks, do we know anything? Are we any wiser now? Not really. The US government shutdown continues. There's talk that could be declared a national emergency. Who knows what's the impact? I mean, uncharted territory, really. If you believe the incremental mover for markets is liquidity and what happens to that, and you believe the Federal Reserve, whether they tighten or whether they remain where they are or even loosen a little bit in terms of rate cuts, as many are expecting, if that is the marginal driver, then the marginal driver really got a bit of a leg up. Even technically speaking, the big indices, the S&P 500, you mentioned oil, you look at markets like China, all of them are looking a lot more constructive. They're all, by the way, after the smart bounce we've seen, coming up to some important resistance levels. So you might see some turn, some profit taking because the bounce has been so nice and smooth. But the fact is, the underlying has turned a little bit better. Surabhi.
Okay, well, let's take this conversation forward. Joining us to discuss all of these cues and more is Aditya Narayan, Head of Research at Edelweiss Securities. Aditya, thanks so much for joining in. Season's greetings, first of all. Happy New Year to you. So it's interesting, November and December, India had a great run. We were outperforming most of the global markets. January so far, very, very sluggish. Is this a sign of things to come for the next several months? Or do you think at some point this range is going to break?
I'd actually argue that this is probably a sense of things to come, because to start with, you had such a strong relative run over the last quarter that in itself calls for a little bit of cooling off. The other bit is that your domestic economy, the macro environment itself is a little wavered at this point in time, or a little uncertain at this point in time. I think you take that mix together, it would be, from my perspective, a little hard to argue that this market will do either very well in absolute terms or do very well on a relative basis either.
More local or global? I mean, in terms of...
I think there's clearly a global overhang, but I think over the last couple of weeks, you actually had a little bit of an overlay from the local side also. I think there are data points that are looking a little weaker.
I'm sure auto sales is going to be one of those white points that you're going to talk about.
Well, I think that's the one that stands out. That's historically been a big kind of bellwether in terms of how you judge the markets. But I think it's also a little symptomatic of the fact that at the discretionary level, I think things are a little tight or things are a little uncertain. And I think given that backdrop, given that the market has done very well, given that you have an election up ahead of you, given that you really don't know the impact of the credit squeeze, again, just be a little watchful of getting too optimistic.
And I think last time you were on, you mentioned 9,800 to about 10,500 being that territory, being that zone. So you basically chop around between these levels?
Effectively, yes. I don't see this market breaking away dramatically on either side. And if it does, it's an opportunity.
You mentioned credit squeeze. I mean, we thought that would be a thing of the past because that's what at least the RBI wants us to believe, the government wants us to believe. And, you know, lenders are also saying that for creditworthy borrowers, there is finance. Of course, if you are an over-leveraged entity or an NBFC that's gone ahead with reckless lending, then you might have a situation.
Right.
But yet, you feel there is a credit squeeze?
I think the reality is that the delta in terms of credit coming into the system lies somewhere in between. Easy lending will always continue. I don't think there's any challenge to that. I think marginal growth that you get in the system is where you need to think a little bit about the credit or you've got to take a little bit of extra risk with that credit. And I think there the mindset would effectively have got a little bit more cautious. It's not as if money won't go out there. It's just that it's going to go out much more watchfully and over a period of time rather than be pushed out there. It has to be a good kind of pull which is backed by credit rather than the push that you were seeing at points in time over the last year.
But how much is it, how much is the slowdown we've seen marginally a result of credit squeeze and how much is it people not wanting to spend, feeling good about?
You know, these things, if we had a call on it, if we could break it up, we'd be, you know, much better analysts than we are at this point in time.
Because if it is a demand issue, then that may persist a little longer.
I think it's a combination. The fact that there's a little bit of a credit squeeze, the fact that your bargaining power has effectively gone down, more is asked of you. I think that to some extent plays through in terms of the demand side also. But it has to be, in effect, a combination. You know, sometimes you get a very dichotomous situation where, you know, there is a huge readiness to buy and consumer sentiment is very strong, but you don't have the liquidity out there. This is not one of those dichotomous situations. Or the other way around, nobody wants to spend and there's plenty of money that's available to spend. I think it's somewhere in between. It's a combination of the two and each tends to feed a little bit on it, on the other.
So if demand indeed is getting into the sluggish patch, that would not be great news for proponents of, you know, the cyclical recovery theory, because we were getting some anecdotes from at least some companies talking about demand returning, talking about capacity utilization levels, hitting those historical levels when you start thinking of expansion. So how are you looking at that whole cyclical space?
I mean, I would tend to believe there is a little bit of a cyclical pause. I mean, auto is not just the only number. And if you look at CVs have actually dropped off quite substantially. You know, that's a scary drop off.
Does argue the point that, look at it year to date, we're still up 25%. Yeah. That's good growth.
Again, and I wouldn't see it as a scary number. I wouldn't extrapolate too much out of it. But the fact that it has dipped appreciably is something that you effectively need to watch for. But I would tend to argue that there is a certain amount of cyclical sluggishness, right, rather than necessarily an extended pause. And I think it's a combination of some of these issues. I think there is a sentiment element. You know, some markets have come off. The currency has been wobbly. There is an election again where if people are influenced in terms of what they buy and sell from with that, I think there is just a little bit of caution there.
Okay. I mean, it just seems like there's no real trigger for anyone to jump in there and go headlong into stocks in a big way right now, right?
Maybe. Absolutely. And you know, my view is the market comes off meaningfully for a particular reason. I think that provides you a little bit of a trigger. You can start arguing valuations. But except for the fact that money continues to come into the market, I don't see any real trigger, either from a bottom-up perspective or from a market cycle perspective.
Do you think we will get that get those dips, you know, going into elections?
I think you need to be opportunistic in this space. And I think to the extent that you do get those dips, I think you should be a lot more aggressive. But I, as I said, I wouldn't chase this. I'd actually wait for something to come to me.
So coming to the earnings season as a whole, yeah. I mean, we've gotten so used to this pattern of going in with, you know, optimism and then coming out disappointed and then the downgrades yeah. come in. I mean, the cycle has been on for, I think, at least 3 years.
Yeah.
Now, this quarter, is the same story going to repeat itself? And therefore, is the market already positioned for it with this?
I think this quarter is a little different in terms of going into it. You know, after a very long time, you've got people talking about 0% growth or 2% growth, which is what we are doing. So I think to some extent, I think there is, you know, you can't push those numbers around too much. So even if you go bottom up, I think to some extent, I think there's more realism. I think there is a base effect that has come through, and previously you had the benefit of that base effect. So there is more realism in terms of the aggregate. Now, is that aggregate built on a certain level of traditional optimism? That's a possibility, and that you've effectively got to wait and watch for. But I think the general expectation that you're going to get a trigger from earnings, that is much more muted this time than it has been over previous cycles.
Okay, so I mean, in terms of your ideas, you like a fair bit of IT names.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a team lease odd one there. There's healthcare, Lupin, Dr. Reddy's, consumer, Dabur, Nestle. I see corporate banks, mortgage lenders.
Typically very defensive. You know, we are positioning our portfolio in terms of our top-down view, which is this is a point in time when you typically got to be a little watchful.
Okay. So when you say watchful, then staples, is that the zone that you'd kind of be in despite the valuations?
Absolutely. I mean, it's interesting. Okay. Yeah. We have never really been overweight on staples for reasons of valuation. Mm-hmm. And we are taking this call that, you know, the market is going to be much more comfortable with strong businesses and worry less about valuations. So this is one of those few cycles from our perspective mm-hmm. where we've been defensive with staples. Historically, we've not been.
So then what happens to a stock like Page? And I'm not really asking for a buy or sell, but it's the classic, I think, embodiment of this debate between how much do you pay for a good business and if that business itself is now, you know, plateauing out to a more moderate or modest rate of growth.
You know, again, we don't cover this stock, so I don't have a hard call on it. But I'd say we are much more comfortable with the staples rather than some that hover somewhere around the discretionary. It isn't a pure discretionary. Mm-hmm. It is low ticket at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. But it falls somewhere in between. And we'd be watchful on discretionary. We'd be positive on staples. This falls somewhere in between.
Aditya, let's talk about politics, more interesting stuff, right?
Yeah. Harder to call.
I mean, you might want to, you know, maybe you'll try and predict the market, but predicting politics, I don't know who gets
so
that,
so much
right?
more enjoyable, right? So where are we? I mean, in terms of where is the market pendulum at in terms of, this government coming back and, not coming back?
Yeah,
what does the market believe?
I'd say the market is clearly factoring in a very, very high probability or a moderately to a high probability of the current government coming back.
And, okay. and are you watching all this news flow in terms of political alliances?
Yeah,
and
quite honestly, I think the market has not really moved meaningfully given what the political developments that have happened. But everything you're getting from recent elections and some of the polls does seem to suggest that it's getting actually
a lot
narrower.
The market reaction to the election results, the state election results, was, I mean, contrary to
what that's what I'm saying.
Right?
Yes. The market does not seem to have changed its view, right, in terms of the levels as exist for stocks. In terms of some of the data coming out, it does clearly suggest that it's going to be a lot closer than what the market might have believed initially.
The market also right now seems completely, you know, unperturbed, even with respect to packages and waivers and universal basic income and all these kind of other things that are being, you know, thrown up in the air.
Yeah.
So at 10,800 odd, the market doesn't seem to really bother much.
Effectively, and that's the reason for our caution, that there's a lot changing, right? It's not as static, and it's not only about the economic cycle tending to turn around. And to that extent, you don't want to pay up too much because you're getting into a situation where if all goes well, you have a little bit of upside. If it goes badly, you have a lot more downside. So, you know, if you see the upside risks vis-a-vis the downside risks, you need to be a little bit, just a little bit more careful.
And what happens to rates here? And do you believe we'll get a rate cut in Feb, a change in stance?
Yeah, so I think the one thing that's actually shifting in the dynamic over the last month or so really is in effect the rate cycle. So to some extent, we've actually been of the view that rates never should have gone up. But that's a separate story. Our call at this point in time is that you're actually going to, it's a reasonably aggressive call, that we will see rates come off about 75 bips during the course of this year.
Mm. That's the calendar year?
That's the
FY20.
FY20, basically. Okay. But it includes, the next
these
quarter
months,
or February. And our call also is that in February, we'll actually see a rate cut.
So basically three rate cuts this year.
Yeah.
So okay. that should drive things, no?
Effectively, yes. But, you know, again, that's one part of it, right? I think you can't base, and, you know, that's where the bulls and the optimists will be, you know, particularly happy that you can make this call if it effectively plays through. But I think it's a mix of a lot of other things, right? This element is something that is actually falling in place. In fact, if you ask me, from our perspective, I think the thing that will drive this market is if you get a stimulus both from the fiscal side and from the monetary side, but you need the elections to be done with and over with, because you need stimulus with a perspective rather than stimulus for something that's just around the corner. But if India is to some extent at an economic level to shake out of its somewhat inertia that you would argue at this point in time, I think it requires this priming a little bit, both on the fiscal and on the monetary side. And quite honestly, a really optimistic view would be that immediately post the elections, irrespective of what happens, you're effectively going to get that combination.
Apart from staples, now that this is the backdrop against which we are working, what else are you going to buy for the next several months? And where are you on this consensus street trade? Corporate sector banks. Everybody wants to buy a corporate bank these days.
Yeah, so we wouldn't be out of consensus. Okay. We wouldn't be out of consensus on that trade. But I'd say, again, I think, you know, the way we've done our last piece, which is looking into 2019, is really, we've called it a tale of two halves. The first half is just sit pretty, stay at the top end, don't take too many chances. If you see opportunity come along, be much more aggressive, both in the risk you take with sectors or with stocks. And that's the way you should play it, rather than chase at this point in. So I think that's where you will see more risk appetite coming through. I think with a six-month perspective, play cautious. Beyond that, or if something breaks, as I said, be aggressive. Beyond that, you've got to wait for that bottom.
All right, Aditya, thanks very much.
Thank you. Great to have you with us.
I appreciate it. Have a good weekend. Well, we will slip into a very quick break here. We come back, we get you some more opinion, this time on charts, technicals, Ashwini Gujral coming right up. We'll leave you with some opinion that we got through the course of the week.
We think it's a low probability event, with the best case of Nifty really remaining range-bound between sort of 9,900 and this 11,000 resistance zone. You can see, basically, over the past 2 months, the initial recovery off the October lows has failed at this 11,000 area on three occasions. You've got slowing upside momentum. So we think it's unlikely that we clear the 11,000 area. There's clearly a risk that we retest 9,900 and break below that and see the Nifty trade down to 9,000 by mid-2019. So I don't think you can rule that out. And looking at the broader trends, which are bearish across global equities, definitely a risk of retesting 9,900.
It looks like that the slowdown threat is for real, okay? I think, of course, the industry, and I think most players have been talking about some kind of a liquidity squeeze and the NBFCs not having funding, and therefore that's impacting demand. But I really don't think so. I clearly believe that there are banks out there who have enough liquidity to lend. I genuinely believe that the next financial year, I think, should be good from an earnings outlook point of view, especially if, say, for example, PSU banks are done with the provisioning and all of that. Corporate banks are in a better shape. If crude, etc., are subdued, I think that would mean better gross margins for corporate India and therefore better profitability. So I think on the whole, I think the outlook for next year in terms of earnings, I think, looks to be reasonably strong and robust.
As you know, Congress party has come out and said, look, we're going to give away to the farmers their loans. In other words, we're going to cancel all their loans. This is a lot of money for the states and for the central government.
Sure.
And of course, that throws the whole budget out of balance. And now we're holding our breath to find out what Modi is going to do, because, you know, if you want to get elected, you got to give something to the farmers.
Right.
So if this battle and this trade-off continues, it's not going to be very good for the budget.
Welcome back. You're watching Taking Stock. Joining us now is Ashwini Gujral to give us the technical perspective on trade next week. Ashwini, I mean, the week gone by was absolutely range-bound. The indices were refusing to do much. Now, what's your advice for next week?
See, this was a week where both Nifty and Bank Nifty had very narrow ranges. The open is almost near the close. When this sort of indecision happens post a rally, then, generally, the next direction is down. And the other evidence you are getting is now rupee is weakening. crude prices are going up. So hence, you know, this outperformance of financials may be coming to an end. If you see the last 15 minutes, the Bank Nifty fell 100 points after trying to attempt a pullback. Similarly, Nifty, once we break 10,750, I think that could have a couple of hundred points there. So as far as I am concerned, next week we should have a downside, provided, you know, crude continues on its movement on the upside. And that way, maybe IT stocks could outperform, as we saw in the end, because of the rupee weakening. So that entire, you know, financial outperformance could now get into being an IT outperformance and financial underperformance, because by the end, even PSU stocks had come off sharply.
Ashwini, so then what kind of levels are we looking at on the downside?
See, basically 26,800, 900 on the Bank Nifty, say 10,500, 550 on the Nifty, and then probably a resumption of the move, because what was happening was that you had an overbought market which was unable to go up. With this 200 point correction, you'll again have some shorts in the system, you know, financials will let off steam, you know, there'll be fresh buying which will be available. The reason we could not cross 10,950 was that there wasn't fresh buying available there.
But Ashwini, the question is this a broader up move? And if it is, then, you know, what we're seeing right now, is this just a correction within that move?
That probably you'll need to assess at 10,500, 550. But if crude remains under control and does not go to 75, and it can, till then, you know, 10,500 is your support. See, what's happening is basically 10,000 to 11,000. Till the you know, election is over, you are not going to break out on either side, because that needs a real big trigger, which I don't think is really available.
Ashwini, what would you trade then in terms of stocks the coming week?
See, certain stocks have broken down, like IndusInd Bank, you know, second day in a running. So that's a sell with a stop of 1530, target of 1480. You have BOB, which is a sell with a stop of 124, target of 112. This crude price going up, and, you know, this bond yield, etc., tends to impact PSU banks much more. And in terms of the buy, CESC is a buy with a stop of 670, target of 695.
Okay, all right, Ashwini, thanks very much. We will see you with Trade Again next week. So, Prashant, I think it's time for you and I to also take leave and get to our weekend.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for staying with us. We'll see you bright and early Monday morning.